For the last 3 or 4 or 5 weeks before I left, I've been talking about the purpose. Why are we here? What are you here for? Why are we on this earth? What's the reason we are put here? Are we nothing more than the moose, just wandering aimlessly on the countryside, browsing, looking for food, and just nothing more? Are we just like the secular humanists the great psychiatrist Sigmund Freud, the great psychiatrist said human beings do everything they do for one of two reasons. Only two reasons why human beings do everything that they do. Number one on Freud's list was the desire for sex, sexual gratification, and number two, the desire to be important or great. Everything we do in life is for those two reasons only, and that was his philosophy. And I beg to differ a little bit, although those two are very strong values in both of those, and no question about that. But we won't go there today. It's another lesson for another day. But it is important part of life. But God put us here on this earth for a reason, for a purpose. And the overall purpose, as a biblical, our biblical understanding, what the Bible says, not what my mama said or daddy said or granny said, but what the Bible says is God put us here on this earth to bring glory and honor to God. Our number one purpose for being put on this earth is to praise God, to bring glory to God. Glory, we talked about that. One day, that's the honor, that's the aura, the presence of God, the reputation of God, all the essence of God is His glory. And our purpose as human beings is to reflect that, to honor Him, to love Him. We do that in 5 ways. Number one way we do that is by worshiping Him. The Pharisees asked Jesus, what was the greatest commandment in all the law of Moses? And there was thousands of them. And they asked Him, what was the greatest commandment in all the law of Moses? And Jesus didn't bat an eye. He said to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, and all your strength. That is the first and greatest command. And He didn't bat an eye. He says the second commandment is like unto it, or equal value, and that is to love your neighbor as yourself. Those two commandments make up the first two purposes of why God put us on this earth. That's why we spend 30 minutes every Sunday worshiping God. That's why I encourage you, if you have not found the K-Love radio station on your radio, on your phone, or whatever, or there's a couple other Christian radio stations in Anchorage. What's the 98.3 or 5 or what's the... The Christian radio station out of Anchorage. I challenge you to listen to amazing godly Christian music. Worship God. Wake up in the morning before you get out of bed, and instead of saying, "Good Lord, it's morning," say, "Good morning, Lord," and spend some time there talking to Him. If you go to bed at night and you can't go to sleep, don't count sheep. Talk to the shepherd. Pray. Pray for all your friends and family and people that you know. Talk to God. Pray. Honor Him. Reverence Him. He is God. He created you. You didn't create yourself. I was at Wildwood one day many years ago as chaplain and standing in the sergeant's office, and this really sharp inmate came up to the door and he said, "Hey, Sarge, can we worship any God in the chapel?" And a very smart sergeant, he says to him, "What God you want to worship?" "Well, can you worship any God?" He said, "What God you want to worship?" He said, "What God?" He said, "Well, myself." The sergeant gave him a real intelligent answer. No. If you are your own God, you have a very small God. I'm going to promise you, you have a very small God. Someone said to me recently, said, "Well, you know, I realized one day I was angry at God for many years because God really messed my life up. And I was really angry at God. And then one day, and I didn't even really believe in God. And then one day it dawned on me, you can't be something... You can't be angry at something you don't believe in." And so, it's true. A lot of people say, "Well, I'm an atheist." You know, if you say you're an atheist, and if you're an atheist, I'm sorry, but I believe you'll lie about other things. Because I don't believe there is such a thing as atheists. I don't believe atheists exist. Now, if you're an agnostic, you tell me you're an agnostic, I got respect for you. Because that means you don't know. There could be, there may or may not be. But I'm telling you, there is. And He's a real God, and He loves you, and He created you for a purpose. The second purpose, to love your neighbor as yourself. The third purpose, and we talked about it last time I was with you, is He wants us to become like Jesus Christ. Part of our mission, part of our purpose on this earth is to read, to study, to read the Bible, to learn, to grow, to become like Jesus. We call it discipleship. We call it maturity, growing in Christ. That's why I encourage you to read your Bible every day, even if it's a verse. If it's one verse a day, if you get that verse, it's good. Read two tomorrow. Read another one tomorrow. Read one in the morning, one at night. Read every day. Get into God's Word every day. I didn't write this book. White men didn't write that book. It's a Jewish book, cover to cover. He's written, every author, every writer in that book, with exception of one or two, was a Jew. Really, every one of them were Jews. They weren't always all Jew by birth, but they were all Jews. They were Israelites. They wrote that, the authors of the whole entire Bible. And so I encourage you to read your Bible and grow. The third purpose why God put you on this earth is to become like Jesus. Today we're going to talk about purpose number four. And by the way, if you have not read The Purpose-Driven Life, I plead with you. You maybe not be a reader. Just get the book. $4 on Amazon.com, a penny and $3.99 shipping for a used book. You order it on Amazon.com and be here in a couple of 3 days. They bring it by drone and just drop it off on your steps, you know, right there. Or at least they do in some cities in the lower 48. They really do. But it's amazing. Order the book. Read it. And again, I plead with you, read the book. Every day, read. So if you don't like your situation, if you don't like where you are, change it. But remember, if nothing changes, nothing changes. And you know the definition of insanity. Doing the same thing over and over and over and over and expecting different results. If you always do what you've always done, you always get what you always got. If you don't like it, you got to change. You got to change it. You can pray till you're blue in the face, and God ain't going to fix you. He's already done His work. He died on the cross for you and me. And He loves you. And He's given us an incredible book that we can learn. Today, purpose number four. Purpose number four is we are shaped, we're created to serve God. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 5, Paul writing, he said, after all, who is Apollos? Who is Paul? We're only God's servants through whom you believe the good news. Each of us did the work the Lord gave us. Verse 6, I planted a seed, Paul said, in your hearts. Apollos came along and watered the seed, but it's God that makes it grow. See, I'm just a servant, and so are you. We are just servants. And our mission is serve God. Whatever little thing you do, little part, we each have a little part. Paul said, I planted a seed, but Apollos came along and watered it. But it's God that made it grow. I can't save anybody. I don't have the ability to save anybody. All I'm doing is planting seeds. One of my heroes is Johnny Appleseed. He's one of my role models. Johnny Appleseed just planted seeds. By the way, do you know Johnny Appleseed was not an environmentalist? He wasn't a bunny hugger or a tree hugger. Johnny Appleseed was a missionary. John Chapman was his name. If you go back and get your old Walt Disney book out of Johnny Appleseed, or the old, how many of you remember the 33 long play album of Johnny Appleseed? We have one of those, and on the cover of it was a cartoon figure of Johnny Appleseed. He had a pot on his head, a seed bag over his shoulder, and a Bible under his arm. John Chapman was a missionary. He also planted apple seeds. So that was his job. Each one of us have a work to do. I got to hurry because I'm going to run out of time. I ran out of time the first service. The question is, are we willing to accept our assignment? Are we willing to accept our assignment? God has given each one of us an assignment. Are we willing to accept it? You got a briefcase, and it don't have $1 million in it, but you've been given the option to accept the mission or not. It's your choice. And God gives us that. It's a wonderful opportunity. Are we willing to accept it? In fact, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, the Bible says, we are God's masterpieces. We're created in God's image, and we're created anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the things that God planned for us long ago. We are created in God's image to do His work. Jesus said, just before He went to the cross, John 17, one of my favorite passages in the Bible, John chapter 17. John chapter 17, verse 4 in the Message Bible. Jesus said, I've glorified you on earth, Father, by completing down to the last detail what you assigned me to do. See, Jesus had an assignment. So do you. So do I. We have an assignment. Are we going to do that assignment? People often ask me, how long are you going to stay up there in that frozen, God-forsaken place up there in Alaska? And funny seeing all those people's faces down there in Florida. I tell them, we've been here 30 years, like their jaw drops. Like, really? And I told them, yeah, it's 80 today, but it's minus 12 at home. And they're like, oh, God, how do people live in that? Oh, they're just funny. They go nuts. And how in the world? And they really go nuts with Miriam. How? Oh, bless your heart. How long have you how could you live and all that? Because this is where God assigned us. Miriam didn't choose to be here. Let me tell you, what she landed in Anchorage, she said, I don't see the palm trees. Where are they? We saw a lady with a shirt on down there at the Mayo Clinic, and the back is those Simply Southern shirts, and on the back of it said, salt water and sunshine cures everything. God assigned us here. It wasn't our choice to live here. I didn't want to come here to begin with. Most of you know the story. They asked me to come here, and I said, thank you very much. No, thank you. 30 days later, I got fired from my job in California. Never been fired from a job before in my life. Give me a raise on Monday, and 3 weeks later fired me because they couldn't afford to keep me. Here I am in Alaska 30 years later talking about singing a Somebody Done Me Wrong song, buddy. I'm telling you. That's a true story. And he's a good friend. He fired me with a straight face. Couldn't afford to keep me. Before I got out of town, he hired a guy at half again my salary to take my place. God knows all that stuff. I don't figure all that out. I don't try to think about it. Miriam will always ask me, why do you think? I said, I don't let my mind, I don't think about that. I can't figure it out. All I want to do is right here. I want to complete down to the last detail what God assigned me to do. I got news for you. You were put on this earth to be a contributor, not to be a consumer. Every one of us, every human of us, who put on this earth to be a contributor, not just to be a consumer, to breathe my air, eat my food, and take up my space. God designed you to make a difference in this earth. Yeah. Oh, yeah, you. While many best-selling books offer how to get the most out of life. You can go get a whole lot of self-help books, how to get the most out of life. The Bible says you were created to add life to earth, not get life from earth. God created us to be life givers, not life takers. Some people say, well, you know, Pastor, some people are just takers and some people are givers. Yeah, a lot of people are givers because they got it. A lot of people are takers because they don't got it. They don't have a clue. I saw a quote a couple weeks ago that said, givers need to have boundaries because takers don't have any. Ooh, that'll rock your world. If you're a taker, it's not because God made you a taker. It's because you chose. You have chosen, by fault or by default, to be a taker. And that's not what God created you to be. That's what the devil has created you to be in your mind. But that's not what God created us to be. God wants us to give something back. That's God's fourth purpose. It's called our ministry or our service. The Bible is very clear in Ephesians 2:10 that you are God's workmanship, created to do the good things He created us to do. These good deeds are our service. And whatever your service, whatever you serve others in any way, you're actually serving God and fulfilling God's purpose on this earth. And you were shaped for serving. You were not shaped to be served. What God told Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5 is true of you and I. I knew you before I formed you in your mother's womb. You're not an accident. You're not a freak of nature. Before you were born, I set you apart and I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Or in one translation says, I set you apart for a special work. For me, every one of us, no, we're not prophets to the nations, but every one of us have a special work and something uniquely created for us to do. You were saved as a Christian. You came to Christ to know, to serve God. That's what He saved us for. Scriptures out here in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 9, Paul said God saved us and He called us to live a holy life. One translation says He called us and He saved us for a holy work, not because we deserve it, but because that was His plan all along. God's plan is for you and I to be serving others. Well, this is going over really great today. I can see it. God redeemed you so you could do His holy work. That song, Redeemed, He didn't redeem you so you could sit on a pew and feel good. He redeemed you so you could get your behind to work in the kingdom. You need to be giving back. See, we have a place. You have a purpose. You have a role. You have a function to fulfill. And the devil wants you to believe you don't matter. You don't have a reason. You don't have a reason. You're just worthless. It's a lie from the pit of hell. It cost Jesus His own life to purchase our salvation. It's clear in 1 Corinthians 6:20. It says He died on that cross to purchase us a life. And so it's our job to bring Him honor. It's our purpose to bring glory and honor to Him. That's why He saved us. That's why He put us here. In Romans chapter 12, verse 1, I love this. Romans 12, 1. So, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all He has done for you. Let your body be a living, holy sacrifice to God, the kind that you will find He will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship God. We understand that truly worshiping God is we give Him our life. And we dedicate our life to Him to serve Him. The Apostle John taught in 1 John 3:14 that they'll know you're Christians by your love. By your actions. By our service. God saved us to serve. Now, you may be a brand new Christian, or you may not even be a Christian yet. You may be kind of just checking this thing out and not really sure yet. And you say, well, you know, that preacher, he's just trying to get more people to work for his church. No, I don't care if you work for our church. If you get mad at me and don't like me, go down the street to the next church. But get busy serving God somewhere, not serving me. Serving Him. It's not my agenda. It's His agenda. I'm just the messenger. That's my job. My primary job. God wants us to serve Him. A saved heart, a born-again heart, is a heart that wants to serve. You may have been a taker all your life. It's time to stop it. It's time to stop being a consumer and start being a contributor. That's really the way to find true joy. See, another word for Ministry is serving. Or another word for serving is ministry. And a lot of people say, well, ministry, you know, I don't feel like God's called me in the ministry. Every member of the body of Christ is a minister. Every one of us have a ministry. It might be standing at that door greeting. It might be out in the parking lot here in a few weeks when breakup starts. You come in early and come into first service and getting church, and then you hanging around for second service with your breakup boots on, parking cars for the ladies that don't want to drive out into the mud. There's lots of ways to serve God. You can, there's just tons of ways to serve God. And it's all ministry. It's serving God. If you're a Christian, you're a minister. You really are, and when you're serving, you're ministering. When you're serving other people, you are ministering. In Matthew chapter 8, the Bible talks about Peter, the Apostle Peter. His mother-in-law was sick. In fact, she was dying. She had a bad fever. She was very sick. And the Bible says that Jesus laid hands on her and healed her. And you know, Jean, what was the first thing she did when she got up off the bed? The first thing she did, she was sick. She was in bed with a fever, some kind of a sickness. Might have been that flu that's been going around. She was in bed, bad with the flu, sick with a fever. Jesus prayed for her. The Bible says, Matthew 8, 13, immediately she got up that very moment and cooked them a meal. That was her ministry. She was cooking machine. You know what? I love good cooks. I love good cooks. I'm married to one. I love good cooking as a ministry. Let me tell you what. I've eaten some food of folks that didn't have that gift. It's not good. God healed you from your disease and your addiction to help others. He didn't heal you so you could feel good. He healed you to help others, to serve others. We are blessed to be a blessing. I'm blessed to be a blessing. I'm blessed to be a blessing. I preached a whole series years ago, and probably going to re-preach it again here, not too distant future, out of Genesis 12, where God called Abraham, the father of the faith, Abram, and he said, Abram, I'm going to bless you beyond anything you ever imagined so you can be a blessing. I'm going to bless you so you can be a blessing. I was in Florida last week. We're eating at a restaurant with my brother-in-law and sister, Tammy and Jerry, and I wasn't paying a lot of attention. I saw this little old lady in a wheelchair at the end of a table, the other table down there, and another lady was feeding her and helping her, and I, all of a sudden my brother-in-law says, then the waitress came over, he kind of quietly said, ma'am, would you bring me that little lady's ticket down to the other end of the counter? You bring me her ticket. So she said, okay. So she brought him a ticket. Whatever she got, he didn't care. He ordered it. He said, well, look at that lady serving her. And he bought her a meal. Isn't that awesome? Somebody said, well, I don't have the money to do that. Yeah, but some people have the money, wouldn't do it anyway. See, God saved us to be a service. God saved us to be a blessing. God blessed us so that we can be a blessing. We're saved to serve, not sit around and wait for heaven. One of the big problems I had with the church I was raised in the old time Pentecostal church I was raised in, hey, we had the fire of God, we had the Holy Ghost, and we had great services, we had awesome, and we were having a hallelujah hold down and waiting for the rapture bus while the world around us was dying and going to hell. We weren't worried about them, man. We were just having another potluck and another Holy Ghost service while the rest of the world's dying. God didn't call us to have hallelujah hold downs and let the world go to hell. He called us to get out of this building and go serve our people. And when you leave that door today, whether you know it or not, when you walk outside that door, you're entering the mission field. You're entering the this is the mission field. And we really are up here because people come up here by the thousands in the summer to do mission trips. Come here. And God called you and I to serve our community. You know, it's funny. It was a story when I was a kid about this. Some churches, if God was really through with us, if he's just about going to heaven, God should have they should have a chute at the altar when you come to church and you get saved. You just get in that chute and he sends you off to heaven. It's not just about going to heaven. It's about serving others while we're here. Jim, I'm about a quarter of the way through, so you might tell Sunday school that it's going to be an hour before they get out down there, okay? No, not quite, but I'm hurrying, okay, as fast as I can. We are called to serve God. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:9, we read it earlier. He says He saved us and He called us to live a holy life, to do a holy service to God. He called us to serve. That is His plan. Every one of us. We were chosen. Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 2, we said that we are not like that, those other people. We are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, He wants to show others the goodness of God, for He called us out of darkness into His wonderful light. See, many of us who are in the recovery community, who came out of stupid, we used to swim in Lake Stupid. Some of us, as my friend Eric says, used to scuba dive long times in Lake Stupid. We've come out of it. And now what God wants to do is use you to show others the grace and the love and the mercy of God. And your story is an amazing story. And if God can use you, wow. One of the things in my anger management class, one of the best advantages, the things I do in my anger management class, my first session I share, and it's coming up in April. I'd love to have you join us. And I share my childhood story, and I share my story of abuse, and growing up in an abusive home, domestic violence, and other things, and the anger as a teenager, and how angry I was as a teenager, and my journey with alcohol, and all of that struggle. And then people look at me and see where I am today, and they say, wow. You were there and now you're here. Maybe there's hope for me. See, God wants to use you, every one of us, as a messenger of the good news that God loves you. You're not who you used to be. I love that song, Redeemed. It is my theme song. And I know there's some people that don't, but I'm sorry. It's my theme song. We are the body of Christ. God called us all together to be the body of Christ. In China, the underground church, by the way, in China, the underground church is massive. They're saying many estimates by 2030, China will be the greatest Christian nation on the earth. China's growing. Christianity is exploding in China, and it's underground. They have a saying in Chinese, and when a person gets saved, they say, Jesus has a new pair of eyes to see with. He has new ears to listen with. He has new hands to work with and a new heart to love others. That's what God wants to do through you. You are His new eyes, new hands, new ears to love and to listen. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 12:27 that we are all together of the body of Christ, and each one of us have a part. Every one of us have a significant part. Whether you're that greeter by the door, whether you're downstairs in a room full of wonderful little children. Thank God that's not my gift. You would not come back after 1 week with me in a room with your children. I would wet their lips and stick them to the wall. I'm just saying, I love my little buddy Osito, but I couldn't handle a room full of them for an hour locked up in it. It couldn't happen. It's not my gift. I'm just saying. Give me 5,000 people for 2 hours to stand up in front of and talk, and I'm happy. Give me 5 little kiddos in a room, and it ain't going to happen, okay? Every one of us have Maria's in hog heaven down there. She loves it. All those kids. It's the way God made us. But we all have a place. If you haven't found your place, you need to find your place. And we have lots of places here. Another one of my heroes is my good friend Bonnie, right front and center down here. Bonnie is she's a little older than me. She's retired. She's supposed to be sitting home rocking in a rocking chair watching TV. But no, she braves the elements twice, 3 times a week, and shows up and sits over here in a little cubicle called her jail. And she answers the phone, and she serves, and she smiles, and she serves, and she's as happy as if she had good sense. Some days she wonders, and many days Julia wonders, okay? But I'm just saying, when you find your place, you were created to serve. You were not created to be a blood-sucking leech. I ain't looking at nobody, I'm looking at the wall. I'm just saying, okay? You were created to give back. You were created to give back, every one of us. One guy said, you know, the biggest light in my house, the best light in my house is not the big chandelier in my living room. It's the little night light in my bedroom that keeps me from stumping my toe in the middle of the night when I go to the bathroom. You know what I'm saying? Let me tell you something. When I stub my little toe or hook that sucker on a metal object right there, my ends of my hair follicles hurt. And so is it. Is that little toe may seem insignificant, but it's a vital part of the body. And the devil wants you to think you're not important, you don't matter. I'm telling you, you do. You are called of God to serve, to be a servant. Not only that, you're commanded by God to serve in a place. And many churches today, and I saw it in the Lower 48, we were down in Florida, there are many church buildings today that are up for sale, that are sold and turned into restaurants or bars and different things, because there's a whole lot of Christians, a whole lot of preachers, and a whole lot of Christians that have not found their place to serve and are not serving, and it's impacting in many situations. And I'm telling you, I'm just encouraging you that God created you to serve. God created you to serve. He wants us to grow up and mature and develop so that we can become givers and servants and serve. You know, there's a comparison that God uses in the Bible, and many people have talked about it. There's two oceans or seas in Israel. One's called the Dead Sea, and one's called the Sea of Galilee. I don't know if you know that or not. There's the Dead Sea. It's called the Great Salt Sea or the Dead Sea. There's nothing light, no life in it whatsoever. It's got a river flowing in it, but there's not a river flowing out. Because of the heat and the temperature and where it's located, all the water evaporates out, and all it leaves is a salty residue that nothing can live in. Because it's a selfish, self-consumed, all about me lake. I ain't sharing none of my water with nobody. And God says, bet me, and He extracts it through evaporation, but it's death. But the Sea of Galilee is a lake that's filled with many life and fish and vibrant life all around it, because there's a Jordan River flowing out in and the Jordan River flowing out. God did not create you to be a closed river lake. He created us to be servants, to be flowing out of us. Mother Teresa said, holy living is simply doing the work of God with a smile. Serving God, whatever little minuscule thing it be. You know, people say, oh man, you pastor a church. Yeah, in Soldotna, Alaska. Hello? This is not the end of the world, but about 12 miles out here, you can see it. I'm just 75 miles down here is the end of the world, okay? I'm just saying, there's no big I's and little U's. We're all in this together. And the devil don't want you to buy it. He don't want you to see it. He don't want you to understand God created you for a great ministry. It was a great blessing for me to be able to hear the reports that Pastor Brian did a great job. Gene, someone came up to me this morning and said, Pastor, Gene did a great job in the Bible study while you're gone. You may be losing your job. I said, wonderful. Awesome. I'll just go start another one, okay? Chris Cook and I have been looking for a night to start a Bible study for guys anyway, so we may might work. We'll talk later, okay? I'm just saying that God, I got no corner on nothing. It's all His ministry. God created us to serve. I got to hurry. I'm a long ways from done, but I want to see mature Christians. And I know that many of you aren't there, but many of us are. You know, Jody, how old is your little baby? 2. Do you still feed her every time she eats? Pretty much, yeah. Right? Do you feed little Andrew every time he eats? You just put him on the table and get out of the way, right? That's right. Because that boy going to eat, okay? A lot of Christians say, well, you know, Pastor, you know, I didn't want to leave this church because the pastor is just not feeding me. How old are you? It's not my job to feed you unless you're in diapers. Now, if you're still in diapers, you're still messing your diapers, you're a little baby, then it's my job to feed you. But you know, and I don't mind changing diapers on Christians, but it's tough when I have to part the mustache to get the bottle in, and I have to use a lift to pick up the bottom to get. See, when you're mature, you eat for yourself. You stop worrying about, well, I'm going to get my needs met. You start looking for opportunity to meet somebody else's needs. And you're talking about growing and changing your life. When you quit worrying about, well, I don't get that. I didn't get nobody to do that for me. Get over yourself. Start giving and start blessing others. And in the process of that, you will be fed. But you got to read your Bible. You got to grow. And you got to be, hey, we're in this deal. We're preparing for eternity. But eternity's not here yet. We're getting ready, but the bus hadn't showed up yet. Yes, we are all going to stand before God, and we're going to give an account how we treat other people. One of the big judgment factors in eternity is how we treat other people. And really, how we treat those lower than us. Someone said you can tell the bigness of a person by how they treat lower people. I was in one of the airports, and I walked into one of the bathrooms, and there was a young man in there cleaning the toilets and cleaning the bathrooms, and it was a very clean bathroom. I looked at him, I said, man, thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for your service cleaning these bathrooms. I hate to go to a dirty bathroom. Several bathrooms while we were outside, Miriam come back with this look on her face. Ah, it was the nastiest bathroom I've ever been in. I was like, that young man was in my bathroom, wasn't cleaning it. Believe me. There ain't no little jobs. All of us, the jobs are important. Every one of us, God called us to serve. And so I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to find your place to serve. Find your place to serve God. In Romans chapter 12, verse 5. Skip down a little bit there, Kyle. I'm closing. Oh my, I got to hurry. Romans 12, 5. It is with Christ's body. We are many parts, but we all belong to the same body. Let me read this last scripture and I'm done. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 14 in the Message Bible. I want you to think about how all this makes you more significant, not less significant. A body isn't just a single part blown up into something huge. It's all the different but similar parts arranged that function together. In verse 19. But I also want you to think about how this keeps your significance from getting blown up into self-importance. For no matter how significant you are, it's only because of that you're a part of the body of Christ. An enormous eye or a gigantic hand wouldn't be much of a body but a monster. Remember the old horror movie, giant eyeball coming after you. Yeah, we're not all eyeballs. We're not all the mouth. We're not all the hands. We all have different parts, but we form the body of Christ. If you've been a giver, a taker all your life, if it's your life's all been about you, find your purpose and understanding. Really, life is not all about you. Life's about serving. One of the greatest joys, and I was in my 40s before I got this. And Miriam used to tell everybody that I changed in my 40s, and she didn't know what happened to me, but I changed. And she said, I hope I never go back. But one of my greatest joys is serving her. See, I get my significance. I get my value. I'm no longer codependent on what you think of me. Although I want you to like me. It's important. But if you don't, it's okay. I remember right on the steps of this church, right out here, I was walking in the door one day about 25 years ago. And I had an epiphany. It was a light came on. But prior to that, I had been a codependent pastor that was totally dependent on what everybody else thought of me and wanted everybody to like me. And my whole value of life was all about what others thought. And I had a man in the church whose family member got divorced. And that man came to me and he was so mad at me and angry. He looked at me, he said, they wouldn't be divorced today if you were a better pastor. It's your fault. You should have visited them. You should have done more. It's your fault they're divorced. And he was serious, dude. And it devastated me. I was like, and I prayed, and God helped me to understand that. And reading that book, Love is a Choice, and understanding codependency. The only one I'm codependent on is God. And I'm mega codependent on Him. You know, it's not my fault. I'm sorry. But I'll do what I can. It's not your fault. Don't let them shame you. You do your part. You set your boundaries. But you be a servant. You be a servant to serve others, not just a taker. Amen? Would you stand? I don't know where to chop this off. I'm going to have to chop it off right there, okay? God's called you. And there's better life than you. Miriam, in her message this morning, she preached the first sermon today, which was wonderful. She said, you're not alone. Whatever you're going through, whatever mess you're in right now, God loves you. I tell you, the devil tells you nobody loves you, nobody cares. I'm here to tell you, God loves you. Even in the midst of your addiction, God loves you. God loves you. In the midst of your sin, whatever it is, whatever your flavor you choose, God loves you. The devil wants to destroy you, but God loves you. Father, I thank you for our time together today. And I pray, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that you would move over this congregation today, or anybody listening by live stream today, that you'd move in the midst of this time, our time together here. And God, let every one of us know you do have a plan for our life. They are not a freak accident. They're not a freak of nature. They are a child of Almighty God, created in obscurity in their mother's womb by you. And you created them for a purpose, for a reason. You have a plan for every one of our lives. And you want us to walk in that plan, but it's up to us. We have to choose to accept our assignment. The mission is impossible in the natural. It can't be done. But you called us to do it. And you said you would never leave us nor forsake us. You would never leave us alone. You'd be there with us. And what is impossible in the natural is possible with you. And no, we don't get $1 million on this earth in a briefcase, but we get life in heaven for all eternity with you. A greater reward than any amount of money on this earth. So God, help us today. No matter who we are, where we are. If we've never invited you into our heart, if we've never prayed that simple little prayer, God, I know I'm a sinner. I know I've done wrong, and God, I can't fix this myself. I've tried. I can't. I need your help. Today, I surrender my mess to you. Whatever it is, I surrender my mess to you. And I ask you to come into my life and be my master, my Lord. Thank you for forgiving me of my sins, being my Lord and Master. I believe that Jesus Christ is God. I believe He died on that cross to pay for my sins. And today, I believe He rose from the dead. Today, I accept you as my God and my Master. And I bow before you. Surrender. Take control of my life. Lead me and guide me. In Jesus' name. Father, I pray for everyone that prayed that prayer, no matter where they may be, no matter how many times they prayed it. I pray, God, you speak into their heart and let them know you heard them. Let them know you love them. Let them know you will never, ever, 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 ever leave them or forsake them. I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, if you don't have a Bible, our Welcome Center has got Bibles. We got some material to help you grow. See Pastor Brian or Danielle out there. We'll get that for you. God bless you. Have a great afternoon.